About 10 years ago, amateur radio stations in the United States were granted access to the 60-meter band. We're going to talk about this band, its ability to interoperate with U.S. government stations, some of the advantages that it has, especially for emergency communications, and how you can get started on 60 meters. This is Radio KD8TTE, Episode 60, on 60 meters. Stick around. So what is the 60-meter band? Well, when we say band in radio, we're talking about electromagnetic energy that comes with a particular wavelength. In this case, we're talking about waves of about 60 meters. That works out to 5 megahertz. Most amateur radio allocations are specified as a band. Lawful emissions as low as one point and as high as another are fine as long as they fall within your license privilege. We're going to take a look at the spectrum that we have from 3 to 7.3 megahertz just as an example. We can see various parts of the spectrum allocated for different radio services. Looking specifically at 3.5 to 4 megahertz, we can see that that part is allocated to the amateur radio service. That's what we call the 80 to 75 meter band. Inside of that location, we have different transmission authority based on the band plan and our license classes. This gives us a lot of flexibility. We can transmit data, voice, and CW. Radio waves here are part of what's called high frequency, HF, also known as shortwave. These waves can be sent up to the ionosphere where they will bounce back down. We can use this pretty reliably for in-state communication most of the time. Lower frequencies are subject to attenuation that comes from space weather. When signals might have been workable, space weather can make them unworkable. To avoid this problem or to adapt to other conditions, we might need to move to a higher frequency to maintain communication with the stations that we need. The next segment of amateur radio spectrum that we had been able to use is from 7 to 7.3 megahertz. While the higher frequency can help us to overcome trouble down at the lower frequency, it also means that our signals will go further away. The move up to 7 megahertz might mean that we lose contact with the close-in stations that we need, and now we're talking to stations a few states away. There are simply times of the day or conditions under which the best frequency for near-vertical incident skywave, NVIS propagation, is somewhere between 4 and 7 megahertz. Anyone who has worked in emergency communications exercises and amateur radio has been in conditions where we lose or have to fight to keep contact in the 80 to 75 meter band. Then when we move to the 40 meter band, we still can't reach the stations we need. We end up working by relay with helpful stations further away, but we don't really know what their capability is. We don't know what their capacity is or even that they'll be there. If it's a real post-disaster or other emergency operation, we can't just throw our hands up and say, oh, the bands stink, and go back home. The EMA director doesn't need a dissertation on propagation or rack up points talking to random stations. They need communication into a particular area. When we need the space between 80 and 75 meters and 40 meter band, we now have the option of 60 meters, about halfway. As mentioned, this isn't a band like 80 meters or 40 meters, but 5 distinct channels. And that's where we have the ability to work with U.S. government stations if that need should arise. Let's take a closer look at those channels in 5 megahertz. In the U.S., amateur radio stations have secondary access to the band, where government is the primary user. Government radio services are typically assigned in channels and may be allocated to a particular operation, unit, or function. Amateur stations must yield to U.S. government stations in 5 megahertz. That means that the channels are designed the same way that they are for U.S. government stations, which is by the center of the emission. Channel 4, for example, is typically designated as 5373 kilohertz. If sending CW, that's where the carrier wave will be. On the other hand, if sending a voice emission, we need to use sideband. Always upper sideband with a suppressed carrier, plain old USB mode. but our suppressed carrier should be down 1500 hertz, which means 5371.5 kilohertz. Let's take a look at what that means for FL Digi. I'm configured now to use the USB data mode on my rig. That means that I'm going to be transmitting in the upper sideband mode, suppressed carrier, but instead of audio coming from my mic, it will be coming from my rig's data port. My dial frequency is the suppressed carrier frequency, which for channel 4 is 5371.5 kHz. I center my frequency for transmission at 1500 Hz. That means if I transmit something 1000 Hz wide, it's going to be in the window from 1000 Hz to 2000 Hz. The center of the emission is 1500 Hz. Note the interplay here. Suppressed carrier, that is to say the dial frequency, is where we start. The mode is upper sideband, which means that the carrier frequency plus some amount is the center of the emission. That plus some amount is where we center our transmission, 1500 Hz, resulting in a digital emission that is centered right where it should be for the channel 4, which is 5373 kHz. This is important to understand for any digital work with FL Digi, but it's imperative that when working on 60 meters, your emissions are centered on the proper center frequency. You don't get to do anything you want anywhere inside of that channel. The channel is defined by the center of the emission. To make sure you stay on the center, you want to disable AFC. You don't want your center frequency to start moving around on you. In amateur radio, we're used to working in a band, so if we want to operate, we just find a bit of the band that's wide enough to hold our signal without interfering with others and get to work. A 3 kHz slice of the spectrum can be quite busy holding many separate contacts. FT8 is a good example of a narrow emission where many different contacts work closely together. Many FT8 operators only see the waterfall and don't actually listen. CW operators also find open places in the band, but usually do so manually, listening for a spot that's open and then just starting to key. CW operators also don't necessarily operate on exactly the same frequency. They typically get just close enough to make through the narrow filters without bothering to get the frequency to be exactly the same. The practice of finding an open spot and just going to work is fine for most amateur radio. The fact is that we have some pretty special privileges, in no small part, because we work together to make efficient use of the spectrum and to support one another. It's kind of like having a highway without lanes. Everyone just finds a spot on the pavement that's wide enough for their vehicle, whether it's a motorcycle, a car, or a truck. Government services work differently. They're like having a highway that defines lanes strictly without leaving any opportunity for lane splitting or lane sharing. Because amateur and U.S. government now have 5 common operating channels, it's possible for them to work together. Should it become necessary for amateur and government stations to communicate, these channels afford that capability. As secondary users, amateur stations need to conform to the operation of the primary user to ensure interoperability. Not all amateur rigs offer access to 60 meters for transmission the same way. In most cases, if you just dial to 5371.5 USB, you won't be allowed to transmit, just as if you're out of band. Those rigs often have special memories or settings to allow you to work the 5 channels of 60 meters. They'll likely offer you some limited options for modes like USB, CW, and maybe USB data. Some don't offer the USB data option, which means that you'll have to use the USB and get your audio into your mic jack rather than the data jack if you're using FL Digi. In any case, you need to be sure that your transmissions are centered in the middle of the channel. It is important to get this right, but don't let the fear of a mistake prevent you from starting. You can get together with others, you can work with low power and feed into dummy loads to see exactly what it is that you're transmitting. You can help one another to make sure that you are all transmitting as you expect.
So you're using HF to go across the room?
Yeah. You feed it into a dummy load.
The North Florida Amateur Radio Club in Gainesville, Florida, got people together to show how to use HF and, in this case, Winlink. You can do the same thing to practice operating on 60 meters without having to wonder what others are seeing and hearing when you transmit. You can work together to make sure you've got it right. Another feature of 60 meters is that there is no band plan that separates digital from voice transmissions. We can freely mix them, as we do in the Black Swan net and on the Buckeye net mixed net that came before. I personally control my rig with FL Rig, and I have both my VFO-A and VFO-B set to the 60 meter channel I'm working, with VFO-8 set for voice and VFO-B set for data. To transmit voice, I flip to VFO-A and use the mic. To transmit data, I flip to VFO-B and have FL Digi transmit. Remember that amateur access to 60 meters is secondary. That means that government stations have first access to that channel. You'll recognize government stations by funny call signs. They might be three letters and then a figure and then two more letters. They might be three letters and then some numbers afterward, or some crazy combination, a very long combination even, of letters and numbers. They may take the channel, and you must yield if that's the case. Listen carefully to them and what they're saying. It's possible that they are asking for you to speak with them. They want to establish contact across services. If that's the case, then do respond to them. They might report into a net that you're working. And in any case, be sure that you are professional, be courteous, and be prompt in your responses. Government stations are not there to rag chew. They are not there for a conversation. And by all means, don't be that guy. The one who looks up one of these funny call signs on QRZ and then comes back and tells the government station to get off the channel because that's not a legit call sign because he looked it up in QRZ. I wish I were joking, but that did in fact happen when I was working an exercise. So that's all the scary stuff. Once you know some fundamental rules about 60 meters, just go ahead and give it a try. Maybe start out just by listening. If you've got an antenna that works on 80 meters or even 40 meters, you should have no problem at least listening. You might want to try turning to the WWV station at 5.0 megahertz in AM mode and just listen. If you hear something there, then that's going to tell you that, yeah, you've got some reception going on, and you're probably going to be able to listen at least on 60 meters.
Department of Defense Communications Exercise 22, DOD personnel will hold a public mission briefing on 21 April at 1900 hours Central Time. Amateur radio and auxiliary communicators are invited to attend this Zoominar to learn how you can be...
Now, especially if you've got an 80-meter antenna, you're probably going to be able to use a tuner to be able to work with transmission on those frequencies as well. Don't assume that because you don't have an antenna specifically cut for 60 meters that you won't be able to make it work. If you are in or near Ohio, you should be able to hear the Black Swan net operating every Saturday and Sunday at 1300 local time, and you should be able to see the link below for information on that net. And that's really it for now. Whether you find an operation there on 60 meters or you get together with some friends to give it a try, those 5 megahertz interoperability channels provide a valuable space between the 8075 meter and the 40 meter bands, and it's excellent for NVIS. They provide a unique opportunity for being able to work with U.S. government stations. In short, it's a critical part of the emergency communicators toolbox. This won't be our last discussion of 60 meters. I hope you did enjoy it. Like and share the video if so. Subscribe to the channel so that you don't miss anything. I hope to hear you on 60 meters. 7-3, this is Radio KD8TTE, out.